from ISS. Today's event is part of a continuing series this year that the Asia program is organizing on Indian security issues. Last January, some of you may know, we held an event on the U.S.-India strategic relationship. In a few months, in July, we'll be convening a conference on the Maoist insurgency in India, which New Delhi has identified as India's greatest internal security threat. Today's event, of course, will be focusing on India's maritime strategy, and particularly its naval modernization and expansion plans and implications. And we'll be hearing perspectives from both India and the United States. I should add that later this year, we will be publishing a book, an edited volume, comprising papers from each of the events that I've just mentioned. If you'd like a copy of this book, you should make sure that you're on our South Asia email distribution list, or make sure that you signed in outside. Let me know afterward if you wanted to talk about that. So let's get started. We're very fortunate to have with us three very distinguished experts on maritime affairs in India. I'll introduce each of them before his presentation, and we'll hear their presentations consecutively, and then we'll go to a Q&A. So the first speaker will be Admiral Arun Prakash, who is chairman of the National Maritime Foundation in New Delhi. He previously served in India's Navy for over 40 years. He took over as the 20th Chief of the Naval Staff in 2004, and from 2005 until his retirement in 2006, he concurrently held the position of chairman, Chief of Staff's Committee. He currently writes on strategic and defense-related topics, and in 2008, he published From the Crow's Nest, a collection of speeches and writings on maritime and other issues.
Thank you, Michael. Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. It's a privilege to be here in Washington and to have the opportunity to speak to such a distinguished audience. As you can see, the subject is implications of India's growing maritime power, and the subtitle has been pinched from what Michael had asked me to speak on, why the elephant is lumbering down to the sea. It was not too long ago when Indians used to feel exasperated that scholarly opinion in the United States tended to either ignore or understate India's regional significance. It was also galling for some that American scholars and analysts were either dismissive of or paid scant attention to India's evolving sea power and the motivation prompting this renewed maritime focus. Things are obviously changing because a number of study teams and delegations have of late been visiting New Delhi to investigate India's allegedly dramatic naval growth, and many investigative pieces have appeared in print and on the internet. Those who are intrigued, those Indians who are intrigued by this eruption of curiosity, need to remind themselves or ourselves that when a third world country is seen launching a nuclear submarine or negotiating the price of a second-hand aircraft carrier, ears tend to prick up and often hackles rise in the vicinity. Indians may be talkative, may be a talkative race, but we are not very good at communicating. So I will attempt to redress this lacuna by speaking to you for the next 25 minutes, according to Michael, on India's growing maritime power, or why the elephant is lumbering slowly towards the sea. First of all, ladies and gentlemen, the Indian Navy is not an entity that grew overnight. At independence in 1947, the departing British saw India as a potential base and bastion against a possible Soviet advance towards the warm waters of the Indian Ocean. In this Commonwealth matrix, the Indian Navy was envisioned as an anti-submarine task force and was to receive three surplus light fleet aircraft carriers from the Royal Navy along with escort forces. Subsequent developments, including a financial crunch and outbreak of the Korean War, saw just a single British aircraft carrier, two old cruisers, and eight new frigates being transferred to India by 1961. As you can see from the slide, this total force was not an insignificant one. It had cruisers, destroyers, an aircraft carrier, a tanker, survey ships, and so on. Now, visionary Indian Navy leaders ensured that underway replenishment ships, diesel submarines, and a maritime reconnaissance element were added, and a warship building capability was created in the following decade. This laid the foundation of a balanced blue water navy as far back as the 1960s. Strong Indo-US relations were established in the 1960s and saw a windfall of hardware for the Indian Navy. Between 1980 and 1991, the Indian Navy's major acquisitions are on the slide before you. And they include an aircraft carrier, guided missile destroyers, a dozen submarines, corvettes, and of course, a nuclear attack submarine on a three-year lease. The steady accretion of maritime capability spread over a decade was regrettably unaccompanied by any attempt at rationalization or reassurance by India. Concurrently, India's young Prime Minister Rajiv Gandhi decided to adopt a proactive regional approach, resulting in military interventions in Sri Lanka and the Maldives. All this led to a degree of unease about India's long-term intentions in the neighborhood, especially in Australia, distant Australia, which used the convenient Indian bogey to initiate its own military build-up. The reason a cash-strapped India could afford all this military hardware was because it came from the USSR, either through a barter system or at throwaway prices, payable in Indian rupees. Through this display of fraternal altruism, the Soviet admirals were not just acquiring influence and leverage for Moscow, but also binding India to the USSR for the lifetime of every weapon system that they sold to us. The chaos that followed the demise of the Soviet Union led to a collapse of the arms supply chain and left the Indian armed forces struggling to keep their weapon systems alive. Our acquisition system, used to buying on credit on rupee payment, now had to face the realities of the cash and carry international arms bazaar. However, since the opening up of India's economy in the early 90s, the country's booming GDP has generated adequate resources for defense purchases, and I'll talk more about this a little later. Let me then address the main focus of everyone's curiosity. Why does a developing nation like India, with enormous socio-economic problems, have such maritime ambitions? While the Navy had no doubt always nurtured a lofty vision of itself as a blue water force at some future point of time, this vision was shared neither by the politicians nor the bureaucracy. It is only in the last two decades that certain key factors have coalesced to drive a consensus across the board that India did indeed need to focus on maritime security. The first of these factors is the powerful phenomenon of globalization, which has done for India what I dare say Captain Mahan achieved for the USA in the last century. International trade, the sine qua non of globalization, is carried overwhelmingly by sea, as is energy, the lifeblood of our industry. Ensuring stability at sea and the safety of shipping lanes in the face of multifarious threats has assumed prime importance and brought maritime forces into sharp focus. Secondly, in 1993, explosives landed on India's west coast by boat were used to trigger serial blasts in Mumbai and created havoc in that large city. 15 years later, in November 2008, terrorists landed by a fishing trawler, this time to once again play havoc with the same city. This has created a sense of intense vulnerability amongst the public about India's 7,500 kilometers of coast and about 1,000 odd offshore islands. Next is the adversarial relationship with China. There is recognition in India's security circles that China's economy and military rise could eventually lead to a confrontation. When the gloves are off, the Sino-Indian land and air power equation in the Himalayan region, given relative strengths and the geographical locations, is going to be evenly matched. The Indian Ocean may therefore become the decisive arena and possibly witness a face-off, a maritime face-off, if not a showdown. India therefore needs to be prepared at sea. The fourth factor, which is more a catalyst than a driver, is the availability of funding. 4 decades of post-independence fiscal stringency that kept the Indian Navy's plans in deep freeze ended when the economy was opened in 1990. Steady GDP growth is now generating sufficient resources for implementation of many long-delayed plans. The Indian Navy only needs to prioritize its requirements. The effectiveness of these drivers can be gauged from the financial commitments made by the Government of India to the Navy's acquisition programs. They are listed on the slide before you, and as you can see, we have a committed expenditure of about 15 to 20 billion on naval hardware of strategic significance. Listed on the slides, as you can see, are three SSBNs, a Russian SSN on lease, one modernized aircraft carrier somewhere on the distant horizon, an indigenous aircraft carrier, possibly much closer, stealth frigates, diesel submarines, and 30 other miscellaneous warships. Most of them are being built in our own shipyards. Now, many media watchers have noted and commented on these developments. and a few of them have also ventured to undertake an in-depth analysis. In a well-researched and insightful document published in 2009, which you, some of you may have read, Professor James Holmes and two of his U.S. Naval War College colleagues have offered a set of postulates about the foundations of India's naval strategy. Professor Andrew Winner is one of the distinguished co-authors, and I feel privileged to share this podium with him. Just as this study, ladies and gentlemen, attempts to gain an understanding of the Indian mind, it also provides an insight into the logic followed by the authors, not just these authors, but perhaps many others. In general, the most striking feature about American research vis-a-vis India is the intense desire to place Indian thought processes as well as actions into known and familiar paradigms. There is understandable trepidation that straying off the beaten track and exploring unorthodoxy might lead the researchers into uncharted and therefore hazardous waters. Unfortunately, Indian mores and culture do not lend themselves easily to conventional interpretations that are familiar to the Western intellect. Let me illustrate this tendency by flagging just two assumptions that make a good basis for discussion. Firstly, that a grand historical narrative is required to bolster support for a maritime build-up and strategy, and that if India does not have a usable past, it should perhaps create one. The usable past phrase has been borrowed from Messrs. Holmes et al. Secondly, that the shape and size of the Indian Navy represents the physical manifestation of its society's political and strategic culture. Also, that India's national leadership is motivated by history and philosophical traditions in its employment of military power. I have picked these two because I don't agree with them, and also because, in my opinion, once they are accepted, they could lead to erroneous conclusions or deductions which may have far-reaching effects. Let me first of all dwell on the historical aspect. The number of historical accounts which authoritatively establish India's ancient maritime past is not large. But this is more an indication of intellectual laziness and reluctance on the part of our historians to investigate an esoteric field rather than the absence of such a past. Nor were we lucky enough to obtain the services of someone as creative as Commander Gavin Menzies, who has single-handedly managed to reinvent the Chinese Admiral Cheng Ho and to embellish his exploits. One need only spend a few days in Malaysia, Indonesia, Thailand, or Cambodia, which I'm sure many of you have, to be struck by the depth and breadth of permeation of these countries by Indian culture, languages, architecture, and even dietary habits. This could have taken place only over centuries of intense maritime interaction. In addition, three great religions, Hinduism, Buddhism, and Islam, reached Southeast Asia via India. These present empirical proofs of the intense seafaring activity and the great maritime tradition nurtured by a succession of royal dynasties that flourished on India's eastern seaboard up to the 13th century. Similarly, from our west coast, intrepid Indian mariners were trading with Persia, Mesopotamia, and Rome as far back as 2,000 to 3,000 years before Christ. A seafaring tradition that is older than that of Greece, of Sparta, of Carthage, or of Rome, all that you've read about. Another historical fact now embedded in India's racial memory is that invaders who came across the Himalayan passes stayed on to be assimilated into our culture and society. But those who arrived on our shores by sea came to conquer, plunder, exploit, and colonize. So, a grand maritime narrative already exists and does not need to be invented. However, our maritime history certainly requires dedicated research, collation, authentication, and wider dissemination. As a matter of fact, I had personally invited Gavin Menzies to come and rewrite some of our history, but he declined. He said it's too complex. Now, this collection and collation is not for the purpose of explaining our maritime aspirations to the people of India or to the government, or even for shaping our diplomacy. The imperatives of the 21st centuries have achieved this adequately. But we do need a grand narrative for reawakening maritime consciousness amongst our youth and perhaps for convincing skeptical foreigners. Let me now turn to the issue of strategic planning in India. In the mid-1990s, the American analyst George Tanam, in a monograph on the subject of India's strategic culture, drew pointed attention to the historic lack of a strategic thought process in our society. His investigations did not go down well with the intellectual elite in India, but with the accretion of hard power, his diagnosis of strategic myopia has tended to regain prominence in recent times. The most obvious illustration of this was provided by Indian statesmen. Given their deep-rooted urge to emphasize the principle of civil control over the armed forces, one would imagine the Indian politician to eagerly grasp Karl von Clausewitz's advice. I refer to his dictum that for any military undertaking to be meaningful, it has to have a political underpinning. And yet, the Indian politician has surprisingly flinched not just from outlining national aims and objectives, but also from providing guidance regarding strategic aims and end states to the country's military leadership for every operation since independence. The sheer intensity of political activity in India makes great demands on a politician's time. The sophisticated Indian politician creates political space by detaching himself from the corporeal and the mundane and operating on the metaphysical plane. In this context, a former Indian Prime Minister is reported to have loftily expressed his opinion that not taking a decision is also a decision. The more earthy politician, on the other hand, views matters pertaining to strategic affairs as arcane, tedious, and time-consuming, best left to the bureaucracy to handle. This allows him to devote his time and attention to complex activities relating to constituency, party, parliament, and of course, political survival. That is why difficult decisions relating to issues like the integration of the armed forces, the creation of a chief of defense staff, and so on, have remained in limbo for decades. It is against this hiatus, against this background of a hiatus in strategic culture and the complete detachment of the political establishment that the senior leadership of the Indian Navy has for decades pursued a vision of maritime India. With patience and perseverance, and mostly without the benefit of higher political direction, the Navy has assiduously acquired hardware and capability from wherever it was available. During the past decade, it has also undertaken the creation of a doctrinal and strategic framework for employment of maritime forces in peace and in war. This has preceded the issuance of a national security guidance or a strategy. While the political establishment may not be actively participative in defense policy making, it is to their credit that they have not seriously interfered with or impeded these endeavors. That function has been adequately performed by our bureaucracy. The military leadership expects that as and when the Indian state attains political maturity, the politician will find the capacity and the time to address security issues with the seriousness that they deserve. The groundwork would by then have already been laid. Let's look at the implications for our neighborhood, which seem to concern a lot of people. India has earlier experienced the adverse reaction that can result in the neighborhood from ad hoc upgradation of military capabilities. While the armed forces try to redress this situation, the political establishment has never considered issuing a white paper or undertaking a defense review which could articulate India's national viewpoint and guide the armed forces and also reassure our neighbors. In this context, it is worthwhile examining India's maritime growth vis-a-vis two close neighbors, Pakistan and China. Pakistan is in the happy position of receiving generous arms aid from China as well as the USA. There is also a regular transfer of technology and material for nuclear weapons and missile programs from China to Pakistan. Over and above this, she neither needs nor can afford an arms race with India. Very soon after going nuclear in 1998, India formally declared a policy of no first use of nuclear weapons. Pakistan, on the other hand, has based her strategy on a deliberately ambiguous threat of unilateral first use. She has unofficially declared some conventional red lines, the crossing of which will supposedly trigger a nuclear response from her. Thus, she has arrogated to herself the right to escalate a skirmish or encounter into a nuclear conflict when things are not going particularly well. Pakistan has thus actually leveraged her nuclear capability to provide a cover for the two-decade-long war that she has been waging through terrorist proxies against India. It is in this situation of serious asymmetry that India has been exploring means of deterring Pakistani adventurism while keeping well below the nuclear threshold, which is unknown to us. One of the devices is the cold start mobilization envisaged by the Indian Army. The other concept is to apply pressure in support of the army from Pakistan's seaward flank through maritime maneuver from the sea. This would encompass the full spectrum of maritime warfare, from commodity denial and anti-submarine warfare to power projection across the littoral. As far as China is concerned, in her quest for securing strategic resources, she has cast her net worldwide, from Australia to the Russian Far East and from West Africa to the heart of South America. She is building a navy which will safeguard her far-flung economic interests and her extended sea lanes of communication. Shrouded in opacity, the PLA Navy's expansion plans are being pursued with steady resolve in all three dimensions. Many new classes of surface combatants and a fleet of 60 to 70 submarines, many of them nuclear, are in the offing. An aircraft carrier might appear one of these days. As China pursues her vision of great power status, India must reconcile itself to not just seeing a nuclear-armed PLA Navy in surrounding waters, but also to the establishment of bases in the Indian Ocean. Chinese scholars are already preparing the ground by hypothesizing that these measures are necessary not just to protect its own sea lanes, but also to safeguard regional and global stability. In a naval arms race that is already in progress all around us, India is actually losing ground because of her tardy decision-making and procurement processes. Let us now take a larger perspective of what we are talking about. For all its strategic myopia, India's political establishment clearly comprehends the electoral trauma that can result from economic stagnation and delays in already lagging developmental programs. In this context, the politician also realizes the deleterious impact of national security lapses that take place on his watch. The primacy of seaborne trade and energy lifelines, as well as the vulnerability of India's long coastline, has convinced him of the imperatives of maritime security. As I mentioned earlier, the dynamics of an economy growing at 7, 8 or 9% are adequate to generate the kind of funding that our immediate security needs demand, with minimal impact on developmental programs. The delays imposed by our cumbersome acquisition process have ensured that we always have more money than the three armed forces can spend. After hitting a low of 1.85% of GDP in 2007, the defense budget has been hovering around the 2% mark. The new defense allocation for the next year, announced last week, has crept up marginally to 2.12% of GDP. And that comes to about $32 billion. But even if the percentage remains static at 2%, because the GDP is growing at 7 or 8%, the defense budget could double to about $60 billion in the next decade. Okay, so the last point that I come to is, how do the other services look at the Navy's plans? The Indian Army has been driven into an intellectual dead end. My ex-army friend will excuse me, I hope. Has been driven into an intellectual dead end by 20 years of insurgency, which demand an ever-increasing number of boots on the ground. As it seeks a way out of this cul-de-sac, the Navy offers it an option by promising to apply intense pressure on the adversary from seawards. The Navy's strategy, force planning, and funding have therefore received consistent support from the Army leadership. The Indian Air Force, like counterparts the world over, has occasionally succumbed to the temptation of trying to upstage naval aviation and to snipe at naval plans, especially since now it boasts of long-range fighter bombers and mid-air refuelers. The Navy takes great reassurance from these capabilities, and since the budgetary cake is big enough to go around, a truce currently prevails between these two services. With that, ladies and gentlemen, I come to the end of my presentation, and I would like to conclude by making three last essential points. Firstly, that India's maritime history, both ancient and recent, provides adequate underpinning and justification for building a robust, modern naval force. Its growth will be guided by the vision of India's naval leadership till, in the fullness of time, the political situation stabilizes and enables a politician to give his full attention to national security. Secondly, Asia is on the verge of becoming an arena for balance of power politics. An unstated naval arms race is already in progress, underpinned by national interests. India has lagged behind and needs to catch up. And lastly, as a measure of reassurance, I would state that India is a status quo power whose national interests will be best served by peace, tranquility, and stability in the region, so that vital goals of development and poverty eradication can be met at the earliest. The Indian Navy will therefore threaten no one. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen, for your attention.
Thank you very much. That was a very very good overview of the issue. We're now going to hear from our second speaker, Siddarth Srivastava, who is an independent journalist based in New Delhi. He is currently India editor for the World Security Network Foundation, India correspondent for Siliconeer magazine, and senior writer for Asia Times Online.
We didn't switch the water. You did?
Okay. So, anyway, I can begin by saying that as a journalist, one is one has access to officials and to decision-making processes at various levels.
Can you speak into the mic a little bit more, please?
Okay. Hello. Is this fine? Okay. So as a journalist, one gets access to a lot of information from various levels, at the lowest levels, at the highest levels, and one follows the various issues that develop over a period of time, and one tends to interpret the issues accordingly. So this presentation basically is my interpretation of how the defense processes have changed or developed over the period of time. So should we look at it? Okay. So I'm going to first start with the overlying context of what I feel have been the major issues that have impacted India's defense procurement and by extension the naval plans. So in this context, I would say that the Indo-Pak conflict, the Kargil 1999 terror, which was covered by Mr. Prakash, Mumbai, November 2009, the changing domestic politics, which includes the exit of the left parties and the majority rule of the Congress-led government, which has changed decision-making processes. And of course, the energy politics in the region that involves China, the powering the Indian Ocean, and sea piracy. So these are the main issues that I want to look at and then explain in detail. So I just click this. Right, okay. You see, in my opinion, 1993 Bombay blasts could have led to major defense procurements, but it did not happen because the blame was actually extended to the police and the customs officials, and the failure was pinned over there. But when the Kargil happened, there was a focus on defense again, once again. So following Kargil, in the decade that has followed Kargil, India's armed purchase deal value has crossed a big 50 billion, as per the official estimates, with every sign of such momentum being carried over the next decade and crossing 100 billion. So in the sense that the point, actually I'm going to explain in the next slide better. One second. So in this context, of course, one must see that China and Pakistan continue to be far ahead. China, of course, is far ahead in terms of defense preparedness, and Pakistan has got the support of America, and of course, it has got arms from China as well. See, major questions were raised about India's defense preparedness post the Mumbai attacks. You know, I was talking to some officials post the Mumbai attacks, and there was an instruction from the political leadership to the military commanders that they should be prepared for an attack Pakistan on short notice. And what I was told was that the military commanders reverted back to the government, and they said that in case there is a war with Pakistan, there is every likelihood that India will be embarrassed, because Pakistan has got its tanks are superior to India, and its armaments are far more superior than what India has got. So the reluctance for battle by an ill-prepared, ill-equipped Indian army conveyed to the political leadership the fact that something needs to be done in defense. So following the Mumbai attacks, India's defense budget was hiked by nearly 35% last year. The new procurement policy was announced, and offset norms strengthened. You see, the strengthening of the offset norm is quite important, because it means that it sort of encourages the domestic industry a lot, because for any defense contract that comes in, there has to be a countervailing investment into an Indian industrial unit by the foreign vendor. So that makes a lot of difference, because this is not indirect offset. This is a direct offset which has to happen into a defense unit within India. So the defense procurement policy was finally announced following the terror attacks. Now, so of course, and as far as the implications to the naval processes are concerned, the Mumbai attack was via the sea. And it was there was a direct pinning on the failure of the defense establishment. A link was established between terror and defense for the first time, because unlike 1993, where the link could not be established between defense and terror, this time it was established. You see, and earlier also there have been a lot of attacks in Indian cities. There have been attacks on the Mumbai local trains. There have been attacks on the in Delhi. There have been attacks in Chennai, in Bangalore, in Hyderabad, in Varanasi, and those have been via improvised explosive devices, which are actually crude bombs, which are placed in targets which are soft targets like markets or in temples or places of worship, whether it can be mosques, and it can be put in trains. But this is the first time when terrorists actually invaded India via the sea. So it sort of, you know, shook India, and it shook the establishment, and there was a direct link between the attack in Mumbai last year and the India's defense procurement processes. So it, I mean, there was this realization that that came in. So I mean, this process, of course, it is happening at the macro level in the sense of policy changes. It is also happening at the micro level, in the sense I was before coming here, I was speaking to a joint secretary in the Ministry of Fishery, and right now they say that, you know, each individual trawler which is there along the Arabian Sea, it is being tagged electronically, so that and the coastal guard is being given the database for it, so that something like that, it is not repeated. Now, of course, you know, when the person who's the joint secretary, he's a pretty senior level officer, he says that, then it means something. But at the same time, you know, India, one doesn't know the implementation processes, they are tardy. But there is a realization that that, you know, one has to do something, especially with the security consciousness and the linkage to the political fortunes of the country and of the Congress government. So it becomes very important that defense becomes important over there. So let's go to the next one. Of course, the impact on India's Navy because of the energy politics is also something that has to be really considered. Now, if you see, I was reading there is a lot of oil and gas that is coming in from the Persian Gulf, from Qatar. The Indian companies are invested in Iran, and ONGC has invested in Iran. Then South Africa is becoming a big market. I was reading just yesterday the coal prices worldwide, they have gone up because China and India, they're importing a lot of coal from South Africa. So all of this basically means that the waters, they need to be patrolled properly. And there is a lot of pressure from the various lobbying groups, including the state firms, that they need a lot of protection of the of their you know, ships that are going to be covering that area. Now, of course, I was just talking to some officials from GAIL, which is the Gas Authority of India, and some time back, about 3 months back. So now with the India-Pakistan Iran pipeline not coming through because of opposition from the US. See, there is a proposal now for an undersea pipeline which is going to be coming from Qatar. Now, that would again mean that, you know, there's a lot of hydrocarbon which is going to be coming in from that area into India and China, and they're going to be competing very aggressively in the seas over there. So all of this means that there's going to be added pressure on the way that, you know, the naval defense is going to be has to cater to the needs. So in that context, of course, one has to look at the long range nuclear platform and the nuclear submarine that India has been testing trials. Of course, you know, one could say that this process began a long time back. The fact is that, you know, there is a culmination that I feel that is happening right now, and a realization that this because of the multifarious factors. Of course, on one end there is terrorism, then there is the fact that, you know, India is in an emerging economy. It's an emerging economy, which makes it very important that the multiple factors get together, and, you know, it adds pressure on the political leadership to take some decisions in the matter. So, of course, you know, sea piracy remains a very important factor as far as India's naval preparation is concerned. You know, some of the industry people, they say that the cost of insurance that has gone up quite a lot ever since the attacks have been taking place in the waters around Somalia. And if you see the figures over here, the piracy risk cover on a voyage from South Africa to India adds $30,000 on top of the basic insurance cost. A further $40,000 to $50,000 has to be added for longer diversions aimed at avoiding pirates. So the Indian shipping industry, you know, there is a lot of development happening in India's shipping industry right now, and there is a lot of cargo being transferred. So a lot of the production that was happening in China, Korea, and Japan, that is shifting to India. and it is also creating lobbies at the highest levels, at the political levels, that India should be doing something to protect its waters. Of course, one of the important factors which I feel has impacted India's defense procurement, including naval plans, has been the domestic politics. The Congress-led government right now is on much firmer footing, and it has it is no longer dependent on the left parties. Now, left parties, of course, you know, they derive a lot of their support from the unions, and they were against you know, opening the defense sector to the private players. So and plus, of course, they were anti Indo-US defense relations. So now, with the government enjoying a considerable stability at the center, the decision making has become much more focused, and this is also going to reflect in the defense procurement processes, because earlier, if you know the Indian defense procurement processes, they tend to be very slow, and there is a lot of acquisitions, counter acquisitions, investigations, so it needs a lot of concerted action and decision making at the top level. In this context, you know, some of the luckily right now the Indian defense minister is supposed to have a very clean record, and the decisions that have been taken are being followed through, and he is being supported by the political leadership, which I think is very important. Of course, you need to see that, you know, the defense in the context of the overall, you know, changing paradigm in India. You know, if you see a lot of other sectors apart from defense are being opened up. So you have you know, changes that are happening in the higher education, you have changes in power, changes in telecom. So there is a culture of change. So people expect, if the people expect change in their everyday lives, people expect that the government should be in a position that it should protect them. So this is something that, you know, sort of you know, trickles up and trickles down, and it creates an intellectual climate of change, and of you know, that if India is able to buy some armament, then it is something which there is an overall consensus about. So it is something. And recently I was traveling to the interiors of Bihar, UP, and you know, people, they want change. You know, people, they want changes to their lives. So this is a change which is becoming more and more systemic, and it is getting getting into more of a cultural aspect, and it's a reflection of an overall thinking that is happening in the country. So, of course, you know, one has to look at the overall, you know, India's naval plans. The nuclear submarine was launched last year. It's the trials that's happened right now. So India will be the sixth country after US, Russia, China, France and Britain to possess a nuclear-powered submarine. Then there is I'm talking about the major things that are happening. There's the Scorpion upgrade, the French Scorpion upgrade that has happened. Then there are efforts to build an undersea nuclear platform. This adds to the competence in land-based nuclear delivery platform via ballistic missiles such as Prithvi and Agni. So over here, you know, there are some developments happening, and of what I read and what I talk to some people and some of the talks that I have attended, in which you know, some of the senior military people talk about the plans. Then, of course, there are efforts to procure and build aircraft carriers. This process, of course, has been slowed down. India now just has, I think, probably one big this INS Virat, which has been described as a toothless tiger, because, you know, most of its the planes that are attached to it have crashed, and but it has been refitted. But probably in the next 5 to 10 years, you will find that India should have at least one or two more carriers with it. So I'm getting into more details over here. So Indian Navy commanders have for long tried to impress the political leadership about India's need for at least 3 aircraft carriers for the eastern and western seaboards. So INS Virat has been refitted to operate for 5 more years, and as I said, you know, it's more of a toothless tiger right now. It's more of the actual deterrence is more cosmetic rather than anything else. Of course, India has been hamstrung by the fact that the Admiral Gorshkov deal has not come through, which again, you know, harks back to an earlier era where the involvement of Israeli and American military defense was much less, And a lot of people, a lot of reports, they suggest that it was the wrong kind of deal that India went to. But now, of course, it's it's India has to go through with it, and probably by, as it says, as the slide says, it should be available by 2013. So, of course, signifying growing Indo-U.S. relations, in early 2007, India purchased the 36-year-old warship USS Trenton from America. I mean, I don't know. I mean, it looks quite old. I mean, I don't know about the technical aspects, but India has got it now, and probably it has been refitted. As far as the undersea platforms are concerned, again, when we read you people in the international media, you must be reading a lot about how the Agni and the tests and the Prithvi tests and the intercontinental ballistic missile tests. Of course, China remains far ahead of what India is able to achieve. I mean, there are a lot of doubts about the Agni as well. But I feel that as far as the BrahMos is concerned, it is one of the major successes between India and Russia, the BrahMos cruise missile. And the ship and land launched versions of the cruise missile BrahMos, they are being inducted in Navy and Army. And the state-controlled Defense Research and Development Organization, DRDO, which actually is, in my opinion, one of the worst government-run organizations that one can actually think of. It is completely mired in red tape and decision making. And it's, I mean, I think that they come up with a lot of reports which are actually planted in the media, which are not true. And I think that, in my opinion, the play for the private sector has been shackled by the DRDO, and it's one of the main reasons why India's entire defense acquisition it is totally import oriented, and the domestic industry has hardly come up. But I feel that with the new defense procurement policies and the offset norms, there is a possibility that some of the big Indian firms which have sort of reached a tipping point, like the Tatas or the Mahindras or the L&T, which have garnered some of the major engineering and construction projects in the country, they should be coming up and they should be manufacturing some of the state of the art the armaments, and with the offset norms, they should be able to get in some good foreign technology and investments and management skills. So this, by the way, is in the actual picture of the INS Arihant. I mean, I had to look for it, and I sort of got it. And this is the first indigenous nuclear-powered submarine, INS Arihant, was launched for trials by India last July, which is part of India's $3 billion plan to build 5 submarines and complete the nuclear weapon launch capability from undersea. So, see, of course, one has to realize that, the Indian, these decisions actually have culminated after a long time. But what I have noticed is that there is a sense of urgency that has come in now over the last few years in the Indian defense establishment, and there is a lot of pressure from the military commanders on the political leadership that we need to do something about our armament procurement and our naval plans, because we are lagging behind. So if India has to play a role vis-a-vis China, vis-a-vis Pakistan, then it has to, the political leadership has to contribute to the decision making, rather than there's a lot of the middlemen and the red tape that are involved in the processes. Of course, the one of the areas that one needs to focus on is the changing of the countries that India is procuring arms from. In the last 2 years, following the Indo-US civil nuclear deal, and a little bit of the refocusing of America towards India, which I feel is more due to business orientation rather than any much strategic needs. I feel the fact that countervailing presence of India vis-a-vis China is something that is overplayed. I feel that there is a lot of business that the Americans feel India is going to generate. So that has culminated in the Indo-US nuclear deal. And in the last 2 years, the America has emerged as India's new partner in defense. The big defense deals include, of course, the Super Hercules aircraft and the Boeing P-8I planes for over $2 billion. And of course, Israel, as far as the intelligent armaments are concerned, Israel has overtaken Russia as the biggest supplier. So I'm talking about of course, Russia remains very big, but the fact is the Israel, for the last 2 years or 3 years, it has overtaken Russia as the biggest supplier. And the deals, of course, include the AWACS and the medium surface-to-air missile systems. So these are the other acquisitions overall that one looks at. And of course, the partnership with France and Britain continues. Britain has been, involved in the AJTs, and Russia's stake in Indian defense continues to be high, with the Admiral Gorshkov, and of course, a lot of the India's tanks and other artillery continues to be Russian. So there is a lot of spare parts, etc., which continues to be supplied by Russia. What I'm looking at now is what I feel is the future of India's defense, which by extension will also mean it will include in its ambit the naval aspects as well. So of course, one of the main changes that I see in the future is the emergence of the domestic industry in India's arms sector. And in that, I feel that there's going to be a lot of contribution from the shipping industry, because a lot of contracts, as far as warships are concerned, a lot of contracts are going to be handed to them. And some of the big companies like L&T are probably going to be involved, are going to emerge as some of the global players in the shipping industry. And in that context, I feel that some of the defense warship contracts are going to be going to the private sector. So, of course, the government has ruled out allowing multinational armament companies to go in for indirect offsets, which I feel is a pretty important decision, because it sort of encourages the indigenous defense industry to come up. Otherwise, for example, a Boeing investing in India could actually be getting into retail as well, which does not focus attention into the defense sector. So some of the major players, as I've been mentioning, L&T, Mahindra & Mahindra, Tata Group are some players looking at some of the big defense contracts. They have been doing some of the contracts they have got in terms of armored cars and all. But I feel that there is going to be a scale up. And they are probably, I don't know, I was talking to an official recently, but probably in the next few months or next few weeks, there are going to be some policy changes vis-a-vis the big players in terms of their involvement in the defense sector. Probably, so they are going to be handed some form of fiscal and tax incentives by the government. The companies which have a certain turnover, this policy was something that was sort of delayed, and it was stymied by the left parties earlier. But I have a feeling that it has now gone. My information is that it has now gone to the highest the cabinet at the cabinet level, and probably it's going to happen very soon, and it's going to go through. Of course, one of the important aspects that I feel is going to impact the India's maritime strategy will be the tussle with China over the Indian Ocean region, and this I feel is a critical aspect over the longer term. And India, of course, is wary of several naval bases and ports being built by China in the region. In Pakistan, Gwadar, of course, China is developing a deep water harbor that could be used by its expanding fleet of nuclear submarines. Ports and other infrastructure projects are being developed by China in Nepal, Sri Lanka, Myanmar, and Bangladesh. Of course, this tussle, of course, one has to look at it from the point of view of energy, because they both are interconnected. Now, if you see in the latest auction of energy blocks in Sri Lanka, this Chinese companies have bid for them. And of course, in Myanmar, there is a huge tussle between Indian companies and China. And again, China has won and is now constructing an oil and gas pipeline. So the thing is that the military involvement and the energy involvement, I feel, go side by side. And that is something which I feel that the Indian policymakers are trying to incorporate. They have not, because that they need to sweeten the deals. And that's what they have been trying to do in Africa. India has been trying to sweeten the deals in Nigeria, in Angola, by involving in infrastructure projects like railways and roads to get the energy blocks. So similarly, there has to be a military aspect to it as well. And because if China extends military aid and military support to Myanmar, then Myanmar in turn feels obliged to, of course, you know, hand over some of its energy blocks. So India has to play its military hand in order to get its other advantages. The same thing is happening in Bangladesh. In Bangladesh, of course, the Chinese involvement is less, but the Russians are coming in over there in a big way. They are negotiating for a nuclear plant over here. Of course, India is in the recent past because of the new government in Bangladesh and of Sheikh Hasina, who is anti-Islamist and anti-terror. There have been some developments between India and Pakistan, and India has announced some major investments in the power sector and in telecom, which is very important, I feel. So India has, India has responded in some way to the way the China has been guarding the waters of the Indian Ocean, which has been referred to as the string of pearls, which can be tightened around India anytime. So they have India has established a new listening post that has begun operations in northern Madagascar, a large island off Africa's east coast, and this is the station is India's first in the southern Indian Ocean. Then it has, I'll move on to the next point. India has also set up another monitoring facility at an island it has leased from Mauritius that is situated to the east of Madagascar. And the latest defense agreements with Maldives, they strengthen such moves. Maldives, of course, is very important, and I feel that it's one big foothold that India has got, because it has been defending the government over there. And there is a lot of focus in Maldives because India feels that it can emerge as another anti-terror front, the way Bangladesh has been used against India. So India is trying to aggressively involve itself, especially via the Navy. It has set up an intelligence unit over there involving the Intelligence Bureau. So again, you see, this is the focus of my presentation has been that the military aspects, terror and energy, these three are getting increasingly interlinked in today's policy decision making. And that, if one combines with the way the domestic politics is also very important, the way because it affects decision making. So these are the four factors which will go on to determine the way the India's military progress is going to be in future. So this is to end my presentation over here. These are the big acquisitions that are in the offing, that include the 12 billion deal to buy the multi-role combat aircrafts, and some of the biggest players are involved. And this, I believe, is going to substantially add to value to the Indian industry, because 30%, that means almost $4 billion dollars of investment will have to be made into an Indian outfit by any company that whichever wins. And India has also made it very clear that the contract is not going to be divided, it's going to go to one company. So this, I feel, it's the bids have been opened, and I think now the trials are going on. Of course, the other future purchases include the $7 billion project for new generation submarines after Scorpions, then a $4.5 billion artillery modernization program, and $4.5 billion to acquire military and high utility helicopters. So to end my presentation, I would like to add that the India's naval plan should be seen in the overall context and the macro context under which India is operating right now. And these factors which I have explained, I hope it sort of contributes to the understanding of the audience over here. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Thank you very much. We will be hearing from one more speaker before opening it up to you all, and that will be Drew Winner, who is a professor in the Strategic Research Department at the U.S. Naval War College, and he's also co-chair of the Indian Ocean Regional Studies Group at the Naval War College. He has worked on political military issues, crisis stability, confidence building measures, and arms control in a variety of regional settings, and he is a co-author of the aforementioned book, Indian Naval Strategy in the 21st Century, which was published last year, the first academic study of India's emerging maritime strategy.
Remote there, right?
Oh, this will not work. See if you put on, see if this works. I can just stay here.
Oh, it works. Neat. All right. Don't have to go anywhere. Good afternoon. First, I'd just like to thank Michael and the Wilson Center for inviting me down. I always like coming back to Washington, especially when the snow has melted. I'm very pleased to be here and share the table with these speakers. I just wanted to mention one thing that Michael didn't, among Admiral Prakash's many accomplishments and experiences. He's also a distinguished graduate of the U.S. Naval War College. Put that plug in. Just so there's no mistake, when they let us out of Newport to go around and speak places, they do so by allowing us to speak, by allowing us to put this caveat up, which helps us say what we want and write what we want, and I think it's an important one. So even though I am at the Naval War College, what I am saying here is my views. This is not the U.S. Naval War College, U.S. Navy, or U.S. government views, and perhaps they might agree, they might not, they might very well be appalled at what I'm going to say, but this allows me to speak, so this covers as well the questions and answers, but I'll do that. I'm going to talk a little bit more about the U.S. and Indian relationship, particularly on the maritime front. I think we've covered a lot, focusing on the previous two speakers on you know, the development of the Indian Navy and the strategy, and I'll make the context for U.S.-Indian security relations and frame it just a little bit differently. And really, there's been a fundamental shift over the past, you know, almost 20 years now in U.S. and Indian security relations. Part of this, there was external factors that allowed the space to be created for this very different relationship. The end of the Cold War, Indian economic reforms, which came really started in the early 1990s, which allowed for much greater, along with the high-tech boom, interaction between the United States and India, also led to the significant economic growth in India that the two previous speakers mentioned as well, which then in turn led to greater availability of resources for the Indian military. And the United States, with the end of the Cold War, broadened its view and particularly took a very different look at India, which was seen through a particular sort of pink or red-tinged lens an awful lot during the Cold War. I think there was a strategic shift and a very different view. I think this has been, you know, consistent actually over three administrations. This really began in the Clinton administration. The president at that point wanted very much to engage with India, saw the economic growing economic ties, was very focused on the tech boom. Also, the Clinton administration's national security strategy was about engagement and enlargement with the democratic countries. Obviously, India being the world's largest democracy, this had an appeal to the president. Even after the May 1998 nuclear tests by India and Pakistan, which sort of derailed President Clinton's desire to develop closer relations with India, he insisted personally that he wanted to make that trip to India, and indeed did before the end of his second term, even though it was very close on the heels of those nuclear tests and U.S. sanctions on India. Greater strategic cooperation and closeness to India continued under the Bush administration, which came into office saying it was going to focus on great powers much more, and that included, in their mind, India. Obviously, the events of 9/11 and indeed the Indian reaction to 9/11, which was tremendously supportive of the United States, offering indeed bases, something for an overflights for U.S. aircraft at the time, which was almost unheard of, or was unheard of in terms of U.S.-Indian relations. And the president, again, personally engaged to get a nuclear agreement done, which was sort of a symbolic change in U.S. and Indian strategic relations, which had gone significantly downhill after 1974, after what was then termed the Indian peaceful nuclear explosion, first nuclear test, and the United States reacting to that by further developing the global nonproliferation regime, indeed targeting an awful lot of India's nuclear industry. And so this nuclear agreement that President Bush took a personal hand in engagement in really was a symbolic shift for U.S.-Indian relations. I would say the Obama administration so far, this is more about continuity than change. I think we've seen that the overall large-scale shift in a positive direction of U.S.-Indian relations, and I think what we have now seen is the Obama administration is shifting to pretty detailed implementation. I know there's been some writing out there by some other analysts in the U.S. that have sort of wrung their hands a bit and saying that, you know, the Obama administration is not paying as much attention to India. We may see a change. You know, it won't be as close a relationship as under the Bush administration. I frankly don't buy that. I don't see the evidence for that. I think the Obama administration came into office with an awful lot of things on its plate that didn't necessarily directly involve India. I think also India, for the first few months of the Obama administration, was in an election cycle and, in fact, didn't want a lot of attention by the United States because they wanted to get through the elections in May without having much upset the government. And this indeed resulted in an election where the Congress party no longer has to rely, as noted, on some of the left parties. And so since that time, you've begun to see more activity on the U.S.-Indian front. And in fact, the first formal state visit here in the United States under the Obama administration was by the Indian Prime Minister. So I think what you're going to see is a continuation, and we're going to get from the sort of big symbolic acts, such as the nuclear deal, into some very detailed implementation. Let me drop here from sort of the big overall strategic picture into the maritime realm. And point out something that I think represents a bit of shift from U.S. thinking. The U.S. Navy has always been post-World War II period, been a two-ocean navy. The old two oceans were the Atlantic and the Pacific. I would argue that the two new oceans are the Pacific and the Indian Ocean. This statement is out of the U.S. maritime strategy that was issued in 2007. And you can see that the United States is saying it's going to keep credible combat power continuously postured in the Western Pacific and in the Arabian Gulf Indian Ocean. And this is, to my mind, a fairly significant shift. It's not that it happened in 2007. This is sort of an acknowledgement of something that has, I believe, been shifting throughout the 1990s in the first at that point, 7 years of this next decade. Indeed, in 2007, fall of 2007, both the United States and India published maritime strategies. First time in a long time for a public maritime strategy for the United States. I think the first publicly issued maritime strategy by India in as detailed a fashion as it was. Again, both came out in October 2007. Number of folks at the War College, myself included, were asked by the Chief of Navy from the U.S. to do some analytical work for the background and underpinnings of the new strategy. The U.S. strategy is actually signed by the CNO, the Commandant of the Marine Corps, and the Commandant of the Coast Guard, so it's a tri-service strategy. The Indian strategy is an Indian Navy strategy. What's very interesting, if you take a look at these two documents, and they're both available on the U.S. Navy and the Indian Navy's website, is actually how parallel they are in many ways. The U.S. document is actually fairly thin, and the Indian document is fairly thick. A lot of very good pictures and a lot of very good text in it. But there are a striking number of parallels in terms of their approach to maritime power and what both services believe are important. To my mind, those sort of things provide those sort of parallels, at least from the maritime perspective, provide a framework in which U.S. and Indian maritime relations can continue to move forward. Now, of course, the question is, move forward to where? Maritime cooperation, I think, generally is perceived by both the United States and India as a relatively easier thing to do than other types of security cooperation. When navies cooperate, they often do so out of sight of land, out of sight of journalists, out of sight of some politicians. And therefore sometimes easier to do these things. They are lower key. One can frame them in terms of defense of the commons or other common goods. They do not involve, for India, U.S. forces coming onto Indian soil. They do not raise sort of historic concerns about foreign bases. However, you may have very good parallel maritime strategies on the part of the Indian Navy and the U.S. Navy and Marines and Coast Guard, but in both countries, these are documents that are service-specific, and they are under the overall national security writ of the civilians and the larger national security policies. They're subordinate documents. The U.S. maritime strategy exists under the U.S. national security strategy, national defense strategy, national military strategy, and is implemented within those frameworks. And in both the United States and India, you have a very strong tradition of civilian control of the military and dominance of overall policy. So while they are frameworks, they are constrained to some degree within the broader national security sphere. To my mind, though, I think for this, while they provide a good framework, we have not yet developed at the overall civilian level, despite the fact that there's some very nice documents between the U.S. and India on maritime security cooperation. They are frameworks, and they are just that. They are sort of very open, vague framework documents, and I think what we need is a longer-term vision about where this maritime and overall security relationship is going to be in 10 years or 15 years. Ideally, that's a jointly developed concept. That is not something that one side would put out or the other side would put out, but something that together they can jointly put together so that they can begin to structure activities so that you can achieve what that vision is for the future. And they're not merely a series of repeating things that occurred last year with just a slight change and improvement each time around. If you look in both the U.S. and the Indian maritime strategies, there's a whole list of mission areas that both navies say that they are part of their writ. And you can see these as areas where cooperation may very well make sense. This is a long list, but it goes from probably the politically most palatable and easy down to things that may become very difficult to do in a cooperative manner, at least in the policy and political realms. And some of this are things that, as I said, both navies do to some degree or another, and at least have said in their strategies, are part of their lists of missions that they are preparing and planning to do on at least a unilateral basis. Now, all of this is a nice list. It's a nice framework. U.S. and Indian security relationships have improved tremendously over the past 20 years. There's still an awful lot of barriers and challenges, and I'll talk a little generally here about what some of those are, and then I'll suggest a couple of very specific areas and talk about possibilities for ways ahead, but also how some of these challenges may affect some of those options. First, U.S. and Indian relations are improving. They're getting closer. We have existing and potential arms sales. You have an ongoing series of regular bilateral, multilateral naval exercises. Other states notice this. Other states may be concerned about this. As a matter of fact, you've seen the expression of that concern at times from China, at times from Pakistan. And so anytime the United States and India become closer, you're going to have other states that may see this in a very different manner and may not see this as an unalloyed good for themselves or for the global community. And so that is going to have to be something that as the U.S. and India move forward, they're going to have to consider as they decide what it is they're going to do cooperatively, how they're going to try to portray it publicly, and how they might choose to assuage some of the concerns of other countries in response to any of these cooperative endeavors. Political will and adaptability. This is both in Washington and in New Delhi. For the United States, this is a very different relationship than they have had, I would say, since the end of the Second World War. The United States has had relations with other great powers, primarily either as adversaries or as treaty allies. When they've had deep defense relations, they are primarily with, again, treaty allies or other particularly long-standing close partners. The United States is going to have to figure out how it's going to relate to India, a large, capable country that is not a treaty ally, not going to be a treaty ally anytime soon, but that the United States is going to want to have much closer defense ties with. On the other side, India is going to have to, if it wants closer ties with the United States, figure out how it can cooperate with the United States and not just merely go it alone. And I'll talk a little bit about this. One of my examples in counter-piracy. India is very wary historically of alliances and of coalitions, and they're going to have to think about, in this new context, whether that wariness is worthwhile. I'm not saying that it has to consider an alliance, but rather, how India operates in the defense realm, if it wants to cooperate with other like-minded powers like the United States, needs to evolve. Institutional cultures. Admiral Prakash talked about sort of the maritime vision. Typically, many of India's strategic thinkers, although not those obviously in the Navy, have a fairly land-centric view of India's security threats. This is something that is slowly, and I say slowly, changing and becoming more apparent to some broader Indian strategic elites and perhaps to some of the politicians as well, that there are maritime interests and that there are maritime capabilities that can address those interests. Again, the United States institutionally has an awful lot of its defense cooperative arrangements tied up in alliance-centric ideas and in, indeed, authorities and programs. These are things that the United States built up over decades to support the Cold War and its alliances. When we do foreign security assistance and all the rest, these are built on models that we have built for the Cold War, often for interoperability, close interoperability with treaty allies. What is it that the United States needs to adapt for cooperation with India out of all of those authorities and laws and patterns and habits? Generally, you have a very sort of different view of how one develops a cooperative defense relationship about the prioritization. For India, technology is often paramount. Technological cooperation, arms sales, tech transfer is viewed as the coin in the realm. If one does that, then that is indeed demonstration that one wants to have a close cooperative defense relationship. The United States often views technology transfer as derivative of operational requirements. One should operate with the United States first, and then afterwards one decides, what you need to transfer to the partner in order to enhance interoperability for future operations. At times, that sort of different viewpoint on what comes first, may cause some friction as the United States and India go forward. It's not insurmountable by any means, but it's something that both sides are going to need to be aware of. Resources and capacity. While we've had discussions of the increase in defense funding for India's Navy and for India's military in generally, there are going to be some dips in capacity and capability. In India, in part because you have a large number of platforms that are reaching the end of their service life, and if India cannot sufficiently either build new ones or acquire them from abroad, you're going to see a dip in its both capability and capacity. The United States also is going to run up against resource constraints. It always does. It does particularly now in bad economic times. It's still fighting two wars to find resources, and some of this is money, but some of it is merely time of sailors and ships and Marines to cooperate and engage in cooperative actions. Freeing up those resources from ongoing operational requirements, whether they be in Afghanistan or Iraq, to undertake cooperative endeavors, exercises, joint deployments with India is going to be at times difficult. The United States and India have a long history with one another. A lot of it is not great. There's been a significant amount of misunderstanding and mistrust. I think, again, this has shifted over time, but it's still there to some degree. And the United States and India have to learn how to talk to one another much more than they have in the past. And this is just going to be one of those things. Technological interoperability. The United States has, built up over the decades, a fairly, how should I put this, rigid set of technological transfer rules, laws, regulations, policies that it's going to have to think about as it begins to have a deeper cooperative relationship with India, about how many of those apply, in what cases, whether they still make sense. And on the other hand, India has a very strong desire, as expressed here, for indigenization, which includes tech transfer, so that Indian companies can then indeed, you know, take advantage of licensed production or take some of that technology and put it into indigenously produced systems. You're going to find a little tension there. Take a few minutes and just look at a couple of examples of things where we have some cooperation, but I can see areas where you may be able to expand this. Counter-piracy. And I very much welcome Admiral Prakash educating me more on exactly how it was that India got involved in this. I understand early on, the Indian Navy was certainly eager to get involved in the counter-piracy operations off the coast of Somalia. It took a little while for the government to come to that same agreement. India is now out there on a regular basis conducting counter-piracy operations. The United States is also out there conducting these operations under the Combined Maritime Force rubric, with a separate and relatively new task force, CTF 151. India is not part of the Combined Maritime Force. They're not part of CTF 151. They do come to the SHADE meetings, which are operational information sharing and deconfliction meetings that take place once a month in Bahrain. There's been a certain sort of India is outside but cooperating. Again, this is a coalition. It's not an alliance. It's, as was explained to me by the admiral out there running it, it's no more than a coin and a patch, which is about all it is. It's not a legal entity. But the Indian government's been a little wary about getting any closer to that coalition. The United States is trying to put this together as not U.S.-led, but indeed U.S.-supported. And in fact, the current commander, CTF 151, is Singaporean. And we have a deputy commander of the Combined Maritime Forces who is a British commodore. So there's progress. India is out there. They're operating. There is tactical cooperation. There's shared information where an Indian captain comes to the meetings once a month in Bahrain. India is involved in the contact group in New York, but they're not part of the Combined Maritime Force. So there may be areas for further cooperation there. Frankly, also, the question is, if India decides that it wants to join the Combined Maritime Force, and if the United States thinks that's a good idea, what will Pakistan's reaction be? Pakistan has been part of the Combined Maritime Force and indeed commanded the other task force, CTF 150, I think twice or three times now since 2003. And the question is, what will Pakistan's reaction to that be? China is out and conducting its own independent counter-piracy operations off of Somalia, but they have begun to get closer to the Combined Maritime Force. And indeed, within the past few weeks, we've seen press reporting out of China that China is going to start taking a rotating co-chair of these SHADE meetings, these shared awareness and deconfliction meetings. I'll be very interested to see what actually the official Indian reaction to that is and whether that indeed spurs India to consider whether it wants to become more closely involved in the CMF operations. there's certainly opportunities here for continued and indeed closer cooperation. This is going to be something that, for most of you folks who are following this, the counter-piracy operations are likely going to go on for quite some time, because it's not a solution to piracy. It's merely addressing some of the symptoms of the problem. Right now, it doesn't seem that anyone in the international community is ready to address the larger issue on land in Somalia. And so these are going to be going on, and in some ways are going to provide a real opportunity for ongoing maritime cooperative efforts. And in fact, to my mind, for those who are really deep into the U.S. Navy jargon, this is the best example of what is the CNO is called, the Global Maritime Partnerships. Actually under, taking place. Second issue, an example of an area where the United States and India may further cooperate, and this relates to counter-piracy, which is capacity building in the Indian Ocean region. The United States undertakes capacity building, basically increasing capabilities, both maritime, military, and law enforcement, with a variety of countries in the Indian Ocean region. It's based off of our bureaucracy. It's broken up by regional combatant command. As a matter of fact, the Indian Ocean falls into the writ of four different U.S. regional combatant commands: Pacific Command, Central Command, Africa Command, and even European Command if you go way up into the Gulf of Eilat to touch at Israel. So each of those particular commands has its own theater security cooperation plans, and we conduct capacity and capability building, which is to conduct training, have arms sales with a variety of countries to improve maritime security. India is also undertaking some of these sort of capacity building with other states in the Indian Ocean region. Right now, India and the United States basically conduct parallel but relatively uncoordinated efforts. They both have interests in seeing capacity and capability for maritime security increased with a lot of Indian Ocean Rim countries. But right now, there's no methodology by which the United States and India would perhaps consult about their future plans, perhaps coordinate those plans, perhaps try to develop complementary plans, for instance, where the United States provides a particular platform for one country that, the following year the Indians train some of the sailors or what have you in particular thing. The next year the United States provides spare parts and some sort of coordinated effort. Or if the United States says we have limited capacity and this year we can only visit the following five countries and provide training teams, and India says, we will take the other four here. The level of cooperation, could certainly be increased. Counter-piracy might be an area of relatively easy first focus. The international community, India, the United States, UK, France, Singapore, all have, very large, very expensive warships floating around in the Gulf of Aden and Somalia undertaking counter-piracy operations. Perhaps a more efficient solution would be to increase the capability and capacity of littoral states in and around Somalia to undertake some of these missions themselves. This may be something, again, where both India and the United States have a joint interest in coordinating that kind of capacity building over time. So where do we go? Again, vision and guidance, the political and military leadership on both sides need to step out and try to define what that relationship is going to look like. Always changes over time, but you need to sort of set some stakes a little further out. The U.S. has to come to grips to a degree of comfort with the fact that India is going to undertake an awful lot of things independently on its own. And the United States has to be comfortable with a close cooperative relationship with India, including arms sales, in which India may go out and use some of the things that the U.S. transfers to India for its own purposes and not in combined operations. India, on the other hand, has to think about and achieve some degree of comfort, further comfort, with coalition operations and cooperative endeavors with the United States. They certainly have in terms of exercises. Again, there's this long series of Malabar exercises that have been going on, both bilateral and multilateral, between the United States and the Indian Navy. But as you get to actual operations and not just exercises, the question comes, what's the political context and framework under which those are going to take place? The geopolitical issue, the United States and India both have very similar concerns about China and about Pakistan. I would imagine that you could probably get them to agree on sort of what they want from China and Pakistan. In other words, if you said, what is your objective If you asked an American statesman, an Indian statesman, your objective for China and your overall objective for Pakistan, my guess is they wouldn't be too far off. I think the issue is going to be the question of how you do it, how you get there and achieve those objectives. And that's where you get normal disagreements at times between very close partners and even allies. And I think to address that, since the United States and India have not had this long, you know, deep alliance and security cooperation relationship, we need to have, you know, more bilateral discussion at the official and unofficial levels on particularly China and Pakistan in order to get a better understanding of how each side sees not only the problem but the potential areas for solutions. Because India and the United States may, you know, want the same outcome but may see very different roads to get there, obviously because of their particular historic connections, the geographic asymmetries, etc. Again, maritime cooperation generally is easier. It could certainly leverage greater defense cooperation. And the mechanics, again, we're getting right down into tactical details there. As I mentioned, we've got four different regional combatant commands that focus on the Indian Ocean. The Indian Ocean may be a good organizing principle if the United States can think about it holistically. Certainly India doesn't divide it up into sub-regions like the United States does. Again, that's more of a bureaucratic issue than anything else, but it also may give the United States some greater understanding of how India sees that strategic body of water. And I think what I'll do is getting a little more into the implementation piece here, but I'll be glad to go into that if anyone wants some questions and answers. And with that, thank you very much for your time and attention.
Okay, thank you. Well, that leaves us a good amount of time for you all, for your questions. So we're going to have a microphone floating around. So please, when I call on you, wait until the microphone arrives to ask your question. Please keep the question brief and identify yourself and your affiliation. Okay, show of hands. Let's take two questions right here on this side of the room, starting with the gentleman there and then the woman here in the front.
Thank you. My name is Essan, and I'm originally from India. And thank you for all the information you've given, lots of information which almost sounds classified. But that information coming from land of Gandhi and some remnants of Gandhi still left on me, that information stinks to me. This kind of shopping spree for military, for whatever political or policy reasons you have. My question to Mr. Winner is, and you may also have some input in that, is... You said the expectation with Pakistan and India and all. Will India be in any position as was Pakistan in the past when they have proved to be more a faithful ally in terms of sending the U-2 plane, then kicking out the Russians from Afghanistan, and the present assistance with U.S. and Pakistan is going? Will India in any time allow bases or some kind of action from the Indian waters or Indian land? Remember at one time, India even objected to the establishment of a broadcasting station of Voice of America. My question.
Okay, and if you could just pass the mic up. Yes.
Hi, Bethany Danilek, Booz Allen Hamilton. Kind of following up to one of Dr. Winner's points, the question is directed at Admiral Prakash, actually. What is the official Indian reaction to China's rotating co-chair of the Shade meetings? And if the Indian react...
Did I miss that?
What is the official Indian reaction to China's rotating co-chair of the Shade meetings? And if it is what I think it is India's recent offer to protect Chinese oil shipments in the Indian Ocean sort of a preemptive effort to stop China from using these sorts of institutions as a pretext for increased presence in the Indian Ocean? And can we expect to see more of this kind of thing?
Go ahead.
I think actually, while the question was directed at me, if the question is whether India will let certain things happen, I should probably turn it over to my colleagues. I can say the first thing I can say right now is, as far as I understand, and again, this is speaking personally, the United States has not asked India right now for any bases or for from which to conduct actions against Pakistan or in terms of the Afghan operations. I imagine, and I don't know for sure, but I imagine that, you know, for certain resupply, U.S. military aircraft may overfly India, which probably routine overflight clearance applies. But other than that, as far as I know, there have been no direct requests for use of Indian territorial waters or Indian bases. But whether if in some hypothetical future India would allow it, I'd have to defer to my colleagues here.
Yeah, go ahead.
No, no, please.
As far as your question is concerned about bases and so on, first of all, I don't think America needs bases from India right now. They've got Pakistan cooperating with them in this Afghan operations, and that's more than sufficient. And secondly, even if India were to be asked, and even if India were willing to offer such assistance, Pakistan would react very violently to that. So therefore, the situation, as Professor Winner says, is hypothetical. It will not happen, unlikely. Firstly, America doesn't need bases in India. And secondly, even if India offered bases, Pakistan would react violently, and then the whole issue would be dead. Bethany, your question about India's reaction to China. The point is that India doesn't want a conflict in the Indian Ocean because it's going to be detrimental to our everything that we are trying to do. You know, things like poverty alleviation and development, etc., will come to a complete grinding halt. We'll step backwards if there is a conflict in the Indian Ocean. Unfortunately, the way things are looking and the way China is conducting its affairs, there's complete opaqueness about what China does. Her budget keeps going up by huge amounts every year for the last 7 or 8 years. So the way things are looking, it is possible that there will be a conflict in the Indian Ocean. There could be. So this offer about protecting their sea lanes, etc., is a preemptive offer that instead of the situation coming to a clash, why not cooperate? If sea lanes is their main concern, protection of sea lanes, we are sitting right in the middle of the Indian Ocean. We can make sure that there is no threat. A, we are not going to threaten their sea lanes. There is no reason for that. B, if there is some other threat, say non-state entities, pirates and so on, then we can work together with them to make sure it doesn't happen. So there is no need for China to make an entry into the Indian Ocean. That's the basic idea. They've got their own ocean to look after.
Okay, let's now take some questions this side of the room. We'll start with the woman. Yes.
Thank you. Surjeet Man Singh, American University. I have two questions, I think, to Professor Winner and Admiral Prakash. One is, what difference would it make to India if it joined this combined coalition in the Indian Ocean, instead of merely cooperating from the outside? What exactly would be the difference? And the second question, Professor Winner, you suggested that the US and India had common goals with respect to Pakistan and China. At the moment, and this is my field, I cannot see any common goals. Would you like to spell them out, please? Thank
you. Why don't you go ahead and answer that?
Sure. In terms of the combined maritime force, one is simply an opportunity to more closely cooperate on a tactical level with a coalition. This is something India has done, you know, multilateral exercises, but in terms of combined operations, it does not have, you know, a vast amount of experience. So this is an ability to get inside and be a greater part of the current planning effort that goes on with the combined maritime force that has a staff that's based in Bahrain that's multilateral. India could, you know, become part of that. Yeah. May not believe that it needs that, but it's certainly if one believes that, you know, the future of a lot of military operations are coalitional in nature, whether, you know, regardless of the political umbrella at the time, then this experience, I think, would prove beneficial in the long term to India. In terms of common goals, speaking as an academic here, I think you could probably get both the United States and India, in terms of China, to talk about the idea that both of them understand that China is a rising power and they would like to see, you know, China, you know, its rise be peaceful and to have it benefit, you know, the global economy and not have, you know, a China that is becomes aggressive and tries to, you know, push its way into areas where it ought not to be, or I think both the United States and India have a similarly, you know, problematic question of trying to figure out exactly what their China policy is. All right, I think if you tried to get, you know, 30 politicians in the United States or 30 politicians in India to agree exactly on what the policy ought to be towards China, I think you may run into some issues. But I think overall what you may hear is both India and the United States would like to have China, you know, become more transparent, a peaceful rise, and more integrated into the global economic community. In terms of Pakistan, I think both the United States and India, and I don't have the quotes with me, but have talked about their desire for a peaceful, unified, democratic, and stable Pakistan. And I think that's actually, you could probably find those statements. I don't know whether we had it, you know, out of the presidential and prime minister's visit, but I think you could probably find a very similar list of what it is that both India and Pakistan, India and the United States would like Pakistan to look. You know, democratic, stable, you know, not exporting terrorism, you know, economically sound and growing. I think you could probably come to that agreement, and you can probably find statements to that effect. Now, how one gets there and what one needs to do, I think you're going to get some debates.
Okay, let's take two questions. You first, sir.
No, I have to answer the lady's question. As a former naval officer, nothing would give me greater pleasure than to, you know, for our navies to work together, and they actually do work very closely together. It will surprise you to know that when we have our annual exercises, aircraft carriers, nuclear submarines, their nuclear submarines, our diesel submarines work together. We exchange officers. There couldn't be a greater closeness between two navies. When it comes to the political sphere, there's a huge historical baggage where America has been a favorite whipping boy in the Indian political domain. Any party wants to embarrass the government in power, you raise the American bogey. So it eventually boils down to that. And even today, there is genuine perplexity in India as to where America stands vis-a-vis Pakistan and China both, although our aims are common. But when Pakistan gives, say, F-16 fighters to Pakistan, instantly some politician is going to say with a great amount of logic in it that F-16s cannot be used so much against a terrorist as against India, and they have been in the past. Similarly, the interests of China and America willy-nilly are convergent today. They're economically so inextricably tied to each other that we sometimes have nightmares that, you know, hear this phrase G2. G2 means America and China versus the rest of the world. Then President Obama goes to Beijing and he makes very placatory noises. So we have, you know, we shudder with apprehension what's going to happen tomorrow. So it's not all that simple, although our leaders say that we are natural allies and we are democracies and so on. When it actually comes to nuts and bolts, there are actual fears and apprehensions and doubts in everybody's mind. And no country is going to bare their hearts and say that, look, we have, you know, this is our long-term policy. Everybody looks after their national interests. So you got to allow for those things. So keeping all that in mind, there are certain reservations which crop up now and then, even though we work very closely with each other.
Okay, two questions from the two gentlemen sitting next to each other.
Good afternoon. Raja Karthikeya, and I'm an independent security analyst. But a couple of questions. First one, sir, is vis-a-vis West Asia, given India's extensive interest, both in terms of its expat population as well as its energy interest in West Asia, if hostilities were to break out, even if it's only between Arab states and Iran, or between Israel and Iran, what would be India's naval strategy in that context? Secondly, what is the status of India's joint service operations in the Indian Ocean, given that after Maldives, probably the Indian services haven't had exactly a chance to operate together in the Indian Ocean region in an operational mission?
Okay, next question.
Thank you. Yeah, I'm Rajesh Kadian. I've done some writing on India. Admiral, two little questions. One, how has the Indian Navy managed to minimize its interaction with DRDO, unlike the Air Force and the
Minimize
and the
or
Army.
Maximize?
Minimize. Second, what was the impact of the movement, what do you think was the impact of the movement of the fleets during the Kargil War, the Indian naval fleets, and what is its implication for the future? And a comment on Professor Winner's institutional culture about American culture being alliance-centric. Others would regard it as more interventionist and expeditionary, whereas India's is more status quo-based. Thank you.
First of all, Mr. Karthikyan's question. As far as West Asia is concerned, I mean, it is our fervent hope that nothing will happen there. And frankly, I am quite puzzled every time, you know, every time one meets an Israeli, he says Iran is going to attack us tomorrow. And very often we've heard to our horror that the USA is on the verge of bombing Iran out of existence and things like that. It's incomprehensible because you cannot destroy Iran. I mean, we've seen the example of Iraq. You cannot destroy it. And it's a very capable country. And if somebody messes around with Iran, they'll play havoc with the Persian Gulf. The world economy will be shattered. And I think that it's too horrible to contemplate. And I personally believe that America should have enough leverage with Israel for Israel not to go completely out of hand and start attacking Iran. So I think one should only hope that better sense will prevail and no conflict will take place in West Asia, because if it does, the oil situation will go out of hand. The Iranians are, as it is, they act quite irrationally. At least their words are very irrational. So they are capable of doing anything. They'll destroy the oil installation. They'll block the entrance to the Persian Gulf. And then you can imagine what will happen to the world economy. It's already very shaky. So really, we, the Indian Navy, there's very little we can do to tackle this kind of a problem. This lies, I think, mainly in Washington, D.C. to make sure that Israel doesn't do anything irrational and thereafter Iran doesn't respond. As far as jointness is concerned, we have a joint headquarters, now integrated defense staff, which works full-time on these kind of issues. They've issued a joint doctrine. There are various contingency plans for a rapid deployment kind of action to take place. The Indian Air Force has created a heavy lift capability. The Navy is already there. We went into action during the tsunami. So all those capabilities are there. Plans are formulated. So I think if the time comes, then we'll probably be able to swing into action. Hopefully, mainly in humanitarian disaster relief kind of situations. We also work very closely with the U.S. Navy. DRDO, contrary to what you said, the Navy DRDO synergy is the only success story in this whole dismal scenario. What we do is that we send our officers to work with the scientists. So they are virtually working hand in glove with the DRDO. And we have a long list of items which have worked out very well. We have a long list of sonars, electronic warfare displays, electronic warfare equipment, torpedoes, which are success stories with the DRDO. Of course, overall, DRDO tends to overstate and exaggerate their capability. So the Navy DRDO story is a successful one. Your last question about combined fleets, I think that was a very sensible move. Because just by moving some ships from the East Coast to the West Coast sent across a very clear signal that something worse could follow. And I think the other side reacted as we expected them to. So this kind of signaling or making gestures does have its uses.
Okay. Yeah, sir, right here.
Sir T.X. Hammes from the Institute for National Strategic Studies at NDU. Admiral, you stated that the Navy could be a maritime flanking operation to take to kind of impose will on Pakistan or back Pakistan down. Do you see that primarily as signaling, as you just described, or actual actions? And then how do you do that without crossing a red line?
First of all, the red lines are unstated. We don't know. Unofficially, they've conveyed them through retired generals and so on, that if you enter so much into our territory, or if you threaten our economic assets, or if you threaten the political stability, then we will go nuclear. But it's not an official policy, and unfortunately, we have no bilateral nuclear dialogue, which is a very unhappy state of affairs. Two nuclear powers should be continuously talking to each other, like you were with the former USSR. So that dialogue doesn't exist. These red lines are quite hypothetical, so we don't know where the red lines are. The hope is that if you exert pressure from the sea, and you can do it fairly effectively, it will not constitute a red line. You're not entering their territory, you're not threatening their political existence and so on. But by maneuvering at sea, if you make a gesture, then you have to be prepared for an actual operation also, as the coalition forces did in Desert Storm. So it'll be a combination of both, that you move as if to mount a expeditionary operation, but hope that it won't come to that, and they will see better sense before you actually have to cross the littoral.
Right, all the way in the back.
Just a postscript. You know better than anybody else that until you enter the territorial waters of a country 12 miles from the coast, you are in international waters. You can do whatever you want there. You can do all sorts of theatricals just to convey the right message.
Emmanuel Thoman with the U.S. Navy. Just as a quick aside before I actually offer my question, as a U.S. sailor who's deployed in the Indian Ocean a couple of times and worked with Indian sailors and different events, I found them to be very professional and great ambassadors for their country. So to echo your concerns, Professor, or your points about multilateral, bilateral efforts. My question, though, is more of a big picture, not necessarily directly related to Indian naval concerns, but in many circles, there's been a great deal of talk, especially lately, of saying that the world has entered a post-naval era, and that maritime power, naval power, is not as important as it once was. And this is just a question I'd like to throw out to the entire panel, because I would love to hear your thoughts on that point of view, and just in my personal opinion, how it seems to be influencing procurements, relations between nations, and ultimately, where do nations like India and the U.S. go, and what do we do with the assets that we have?
I think the bigger of the two navies should answer this question. You've got much more to lose than us.
I think the U.S. Navy, like every service, is always thinking about its place and what it can contribute to supporting the national interests and defending the national interests. The U.S. Navy is, always in that sort of, okay, how is it that it contributes in the current environment? And I would say probably over the past 7 or 8 years, there's been debates within the U.S. Navy. You're probably familiar with them, about sort of, on the one hand, is the U.S. Navy need to be more of a brown water Navy? Do they need to support the, what was once called the global war on terrorism, contribute more with, sailors on the beach or over the beach, more special forces, more engineers, CBs, and structure a force and, procure and train and equip a force that can become more of a counterterrorism, counterinsurgency supporting force. The other piece is to say, no, actually, the U.S. Navy is a strategic reserve. It should ought to keep and bolster its blue water capabilities against some future, blue water threat. I think we can all figure out what that might be. Or can you somehow build some mix of a high-low force where you've got some capabilities on one hand, some capabilities on the other? That debate's going to, go on and on, whether it's, at Newport or out in Monterey or, in the halls of the Pentagon, and certainly on Capitol Hill when it comes to procurement issues. I would point out, and I think it's reflected fairly well in terms of in both the U.S. Maritime strategy and in the Indian Navy strategy, maritime strategy, that maritime forces have a tremendous number of uses in peacetime, crisis, and war, and provide policymakers with a very wide range of tools. And I don't think their relevance is going away. And in fact, you know, in an awful lot of contingencies, maritime forces can do things in ways that other forces cannot. Often, because they operate in the global maritime commons, they often come with a very small footprint. They can come, do what they need to do, and leave without support of bases and putting too many troops on the ground, which may cause political problems in whatever the host country is. So, you know, my general argument, not surprisingly from where I sit, is that there's an ongoing need for maritime forces, and in fact, they provide a pretty wide range of options for policymakers, which is something policymakers almost always want.
Well, I couldn't have said this better myself, but actually, maritime forces and air forces are not mutually exclusive. Their roles are so different that both can exist. But actually speaking, I understand that the current question which is going around in the U.S. Air Force is that is there still a need for an independent U.S. United States Air Force? There's a serious debate going on in that. And the other issue is that with the advent of unmanned combat aircraft, aerial vehicles, there probably won't be a manned Air Force left very soon. But let me assure you that navies will still be around for the next foreseeable hundreds of years or foreseeable future, because navies have a role to perform which cannot be performed by anybody else, neither by land forces nor by air forces. As Andrew said, you can posture, you can send messages without being intrusive. You don't need to put your footprint on somebody else's country to send a clear message across. And once the message has gone home, you can retire gracefully and disappear over the horizon without causing any turbulence anywhere. So there are advantages to maritime forces which will never be replaced by any other kind of force. Happily continue being a sailor without any worries.
I would like to add a point over here. You know, recently I was part of discussions with some officials, and they said, you know, India should be prepared for what they termed as an intelligent warfare as well. You know, it's not a question of just an all-out war over here. But the fact of the matter is that, you know, something like what Israel did in UAE, there was a lot of debate over there. You know, should India resort to something like that in Pakistan? And I believe that this is a thinking that is going on at the highest levels. And it's very much a possibility, because there is a thought and there is a vision that, you know, India cannot be a sitting duck all the time, because, you know, information now is available, you know, via the satellite. There's a lot of intelligence that is being shared by America as well, which has been given to India. So the question is, if there is a pinpointed action that needs to be undertaken, even if it's secretly done, I think, you know, something like, you know, the Navy, you know, could play a very important role, and you know, in terms of secrecy and in terms of swift action, I think that's important.
Sir, you had a question. Yeah.
Thank you. Admiral Prakash, this would be for you. I've just not so much a question as just a comment. I was interested in your comment that in the unlikely circumstance that India were to offer, let's say, basing rights to the United States, it would be, I think your word was, it wouldn't happen because of the U.S. Concern about the Pakistani reaction. I might just add that I think that the dehyphenation of India and Pakistan in U.S. policy has gone farther than you may imagine. Certainly we're aware that many things that the U.S. does in Pakistan cause discomfort in India. But the same is true with India. I deal with Pakistani military officers on a regular basis, and you would be surprised how many general officers honestly believe right now that the U.S. has already shifted its strategic emphasis from Pakistan to India. And particularly since the U.S.-India nuclear accord, some of them really think that we've sold out Pakistan. If you look at the more hysterical parts of Pakistan, in which there are many, there are people who honestly believe that the U.S. and India have some kind of a secret accord already, and we're working together clandestinely to destabilize and fragment Pakistan so that India can undo partition and the U.S. can steal their nukes. There's all kinds of craziness that goes on there, and it doesn't, I promise you, it will not in the least affect the progress of our military cooperation, our arms sales, and so forth. So I don't think that the Pakistani reaction is going to be a limiting factor.
Thank you for that comment, sir. But I would just like to make a comment on what you said. The fact is that Pakistan is a key factor right now in your operations in Afghanistan. So you can't afford to upset them, regardless of what the equation is. So that's one major factor. I mean, for example, we are trying to help out in Afghanistan. We've given $1 billion worth of aid. We've sent people to, you know, schools and medical and engineering and roads and so on, which seems to